Excitingly, a very special bird has just arrived home, and that bird is the woodland kingfisher. And if you listen very carefully to both Brent's drive and to Byron's drive and to the walk, you will hear... And that's what the woodland kingfisher does. So I hope that we'll be able to find you one. He's a very beautiful bird with a bright red beak, a long beak, and a bright blue back. So now I'm going to ask you all in your classrooms right now, in the count of three, with me, go chip, brrr. Are you ready? One, two, three. So we'll try and find that bird for you. Now you may also have noticed over there is Aubrey. Now Aubrey is a tracker. He's a very fine tracker, and he's going to be watching out for animals while we walk through here. He'll be finding us some small things, I'm sure, some scorpions, maybe some insects, and if there are any elephants or buffalo or that sort of thing, he'll spot them too. While we're looking for those creatures, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith and find out what he is going to be doing with you this afternoon.
Well, welcome, welcome, guys. So great to have you on your very own African safari in school. I wish I could have done that while I was in school. My name is Brent, and on camera with me today is Viam, and we're going to go look for some lions. And we found some lions not far from here this morning. Well, someone else found them, told us where they were, so we trundled along, and we're going to do that. So I'm looking forward to having all your questions soon. And it is wonderful to have you. As you can see, it's nice and green. We've had a little bit of rain, and James has already told you about the woodlands kingfisher. So I don't know how he did the call, but when I do the call, it sounds something like this. So we'll see if we can find you one calling, because the woodlands does a much better job than any of us. Okay, so the lions weren't too far from here, but it's really, really hot today. It's 99 degrees Fahrenheit. So we're keeping our air conditioner on at the moment, which means I'm driving. Hello, Avea. Avea would like to know, what habitat are we driving through right now? Avea, as a general rule, it's called savanna. This particular area where we are at the moment is actually broad-leafed woodland, so it's lots of different trees interspersed by open grasslands. And savanna is one of the biggest habitats in Africa. There's lots of different types of savanna, but most of the savanna we've got here is made up of bush willow trees, marula trees, terminalia trees, and also acacia trees. So we're very lucky. It's a very good area for animals. And Avea would also like to know, has the season been typical? Well, yes, it has. Well, not before. We're getting about a normal amount of rain for this time of the year, although this year during our winter months, which is our dry time of the year, we've had the worst drought in 100 years. So some of the animals are still struggling with that, but it is looking better. As you can see, there's green, the grass is starting to grow, so hopefully we'll get a lot more rain and the animals will be much happier. Okay, now there's a little water hole up here that the lions might have come to because it's so hot to have a drink. They killed a buffalo not too far from here. So at the moment, or actually our lions here, their favorite food is buffalo because it's big and means when they kill one, they can eat it for 2 or 3 days. A big buffalo can weigh about 2,000 pounds. So let's check carefully if there's any lions next to the waterhole in the shade. Nope, so they must still be where we left them this morning. Now, when lions are full, they don't like to move too much. They like to sleep, and they can sleep a lot. And on average, a lion will sleep for 20 hours in a day. And when it's hot, they sleep more. So the lions are probably not going to move too much today. They'll probably only get up once it's dark. Now, lions are mostly nocturnal, which means they move around at night. But all animals out here are opportunists. So if something happens that they want to move around during the day, if something walks up to them, they will. But because they're not very good at dealing with heat, they probably won't move around too much. Daniel? Daniel's wondering how many water holes do we have nearby. Well, Daniel, it completely depends. So during the rainy season, we've got lots of water holes, but sort of permanent or semi-permanent water holes, we've got 1, 2, 3, we've got 4 semi-permanent water holes in this area. Now, I'll be very surprised if the lions have moved, but the animals out here like to surprise us, because I'm coming to where I saw the lions this morning and I can see a little steenbokkie. Now it's possible that that little antelope hasn't seen the lions. Oh, there he goes. And they're sleeping somewhere in the shade here. Now, let's have a look. The buffalo they killed is over there. Okay, well, I'm gonna look around here to see if I can find the lions, but they look like they might have moved to surprise me. And that's the one thing about the bush. It's always full of surprises, and we're live, so you never know what's gonna happen next. So while we try to find the rest of these lions, Byron has found some more.
And look what we've found. Hello, everyone. We've found, it looks like, 2 or 3 little cubs hiding in the shade at the moment. I can't really see. It looks just like it might be the 2. What a nice surprise this is. I'm not sure where the rest of them are, though. Just the 2 in the shade, but I'm sure that the females and perhaps the rest of the cubs are in the area. They must be around here somewhere. And hello, my name is Byron, and with me on camera is Jandre this afternoon, and it's lovely to have all of you with us. And I'm glad we've managed to just find these lions. I've been looking for them and I've just found them, but it is very, very hot. So these lion cubs are doing what lions do best in the heat, and that's to try and rest and relax in the shade. Now I'm busy scanning around while we are sitting here to find the females. Michael, a very good question. You want to know, how do we find the animals when they are so well camouflaged? So Michael, what we do is we try to look for tracks, and we try to find their footprints walking across the roads perhaps, or on paths in the bush. And that is the best way to try and find these animals that are so camouflaged. And also we try and keep a very, very good eye out. We look very, very carefully while we are driving. And if you spend a lot of time in nature and in the bush, you tend to pick up the animals a little bit easier. You know what to look for, and it might be easier to spot the animals than it usually is. But the camouflage does make it difficult, but it helps if we know where their tracks are and if we can follow them that way to try and find them. Gage, we've only seen 2 little lions. These are the little cubs. They're still very, very young, and I'm not sure where the rest of them are. I will have a look around this area soon. We'll start driving around and just have a look. But this pride, Gage, there are 5 lionesses and 6 cubs in this pride. So it's a wonderful size for a pride of lions. And a pride is another name for the family or the group of lions. Now, I'm not sure where the rest of them are. They're possibly just lying in the shade somewhere. Now, Avion, you'd like to know how old these lion cubs are. So these lion cubs are about 6 months old now. I think they were born, if I'm not mistaken, around June. So June, July, August, September, October, November. Almost 7 months, between 6 and 7 months old. And they're still quite small, And they still rely so much on their mothers, on the female lions, to provide food for them. Now, Brent mentioned earlier how lions like to feed on buffalo, and Connor, you've asked, how do they bring down the lion, or how do they hunt the lion? How do the lions hunt the buffalo? And do they use a strategy? So they do, Connor, they do indeed. Lions are very, very intelligent. And they'll work together as a pride to try and hunt a buffalo, especially something as big and as powerful as a buffalo. So when the buffalo is moving through an area, usually what happens is the lions will work to try and surround that buffalo and perhaps try and separate it from the rest of the herd. And then what happens is they'll try and run and pounce, and all of them will go together to try and pull that buffalo down and kill it and feed on it. It's not easy because a buffalo is very, very powerful. But it does take quite a bit of effort from all of them. I'm just looking at some birds flying above us. Let's have a look here. You see them, two very beautiful. Look at that. Oh, wonderful. Two lilac-breasted rollers. And they are very beautiful birds. Look at that. Now, I'm not sure why they were making so much noise. It looks like they're just displaying. Listen to that very, very harsh call. For a bird with such beautiful colors, it's got a very, very harsh call. And there are about 7 different colors on that bird, everyone. So try and have a good look and see how many colors you can see. Look, while it flies, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful blue. It's a bit difficult to keep up with the birds, they're so fast. But that isn't that fantastic? So while we're sitting with the lions, there's still so much going on around us, especially with the birds calling and making a noise. I know James said you must try and listen out for woodland kingfisher while we are on safari, and I'll keep a good ear out, and if I hear it, I'll try point it out to you. These little cubs seem very comfortable in the shade. It's probably much cooler under there than it is obviously in the sun. But it's still very, very hot for them. And that's why they don't move around too much during the day. They don't like the heat, just like us. Nicholas, it's funny, you ask, how do they stand the heat with all that fur? And you know, all these animals adapt very well to the type of surroundings and the weather or the climate that they happen to experience in these areas. So what happens is there are ways for lions to keep cool. They'll try and pant a lot, and that helps cool the body down. They'll lie in the shade. They won't stay out in the open. So that all of that helps them stay cool, especially with their coats. But animals adapt to different climate times, climate situations. So very, very, very different to us. I mean, we take all our clothing off if we're very hot and jump into the pool, and we'll put a lot of jerseys on if we're very cold. The lions don't have to do that. Now, I'm going to see if I can find the rest of the pride. While I do that, let's head back to my friend James on the bushwalk and see what he has found.
I have found a little piece of grass. Now, I know to some people, compared with lions, grass isn't very important. But of course, it's massively important. Without grass, none of the animals that the lions eat would be able to survive. Now, this particular grass is very beautiful, but it's actually not very good to eat. And that's probably why it survived. You see, it tastes like bad sort of straw. Now that's the seeds. So all the seeds are in this grass here, and it's called Aristida or three awn. And awns are these little sort of spiky bits that are on the ends of the seeds, and inside at the end of each one is a tiny little seed of the grass, and the awns will help it to go when the wind blows. Off they will go, and that's how they disperse. Now disperse means they move around, and that's where they grow. Then over here on the bottom, we've got the leaves. Now, if you're an animal and you like to eat grass, this is what you eat. You don't want to eat the seeds and the hard sort of strawy stuff that the seeds grow on. That's called the culm or the stalk. You like to eat the leaves. Now, the leaves of this particular one, not so bad when they're green, but not very good at all. Now let's try and find a nice piece of grass to eat. I'll show you. It's a bit like some of you might like to eat spinach, which is quite good for us, but if you go outside and say you find the leaf of an oak tree, that's disgusting to eat. Come and have a look here. Hello, Caleb. While we look for a good piece of grass, you've asked a very sophisticated question. You say, how many different kinds of savanna habitats are there in the world? Caleb, I'm struggling to believe that that is a question from an elementary school student. You're obviously very clever indeed, so thank you for your question. Well, savanna habitats, it's difficult to say how many there are. It's probably a little easier to say where they are. So what you do is you'll find them all over, for example, East Africa, and you'll find them over Southern Africa here. Then I suppose you might find savanna habitats in places like Patagonia in South America, or up sort of towards the fringes of the Amazon. And then I guess you might find savanna habitats in parts of Northern Europe and that sort of thing. And down into India, absolutely plenty of savanna habitats, even in the far east of Russia. So lots of different places, difficult to say where exactly. But strictly speaking, of course, savanna, for those of you who don't know, is an area like this where you'd have lots of grassland interspersed with trees. This is actually more woodland than it is savanna. There's more trees than there would be in a savanna area. Savannah, you've all seen The Lion King, right? If you go and look at The Lion King, well, that's the kind of habitat that we'd call savannah, with wide open spaces with just the odd tree popped up in between. Now, here's a much better grass. Can you see it's thicker? It's a deeper green, and this is like the spinach for a buffalo. Tastes much better than that nasty three-horn. Right, come on, let's keep walking. It's quite hot here, as I said. And it's still very nice, however, to be out here. Now, Anaya, you're wondering about drought and whether it's over and if flooding is a problem. The drought is definitely over. If we look around here with Brian, you can see that it's green on the ground, and that's because there's grass. Grass only goes green after it's had rain, and that means, of course, the drought is over. Is flooding a problem? Well, not so much in this area, because in this area, of course, there are no major rivers. But just about, say, 5 miles down from here, there's a big river called the Sand River, and on that river there are a whole lot of camps where people go on holiday and that sort of thing, and quite often if there's a big rain, those camps will get washed away. So that is a little bit dangerous. That's the kind of flooding that we have here. But the rivers here, even some of the, I mean, there's a small river just off there, probably about a mile that way off to the east, and that will flow probably once every 2 years or so, but not enough to flood anywhere. So there's not a lot of rain in an area like this. But of course in other parts of South Africa, lots of flooding up on the High Veld, which means the highlands in near Johannesburg. Sometimes they have flooding down in the Cape, near Cape Town, very famous part of the world. They do have flooding, but that's in the winter time. It's a different kind of climate. Right, let's keep going here. We haven't seen too much just yet. We've seen one or two impala, which was quite nice. De Avion, you say, why am I eating the grass? Now, that's a very good question. The reason I'm eating the grass, De Avion, is that I didn't have any lunch today, did I, Brian?
No, you didn't.
No, I didn't, so I'm very, very hungry. I did have lunch today, De Avion. The reason I'm eating the grass is because I find it very interesting to taste what the animals are tasting. And while this would not be good for me to eat, or it wouldn't be a good substitute for food for me to eat, it's very nice to taste. And so what you will do is you read in books that some grasses are good for animals to eat and some grasses are not so good for animals to eat. And you can actually taste the difference as a human. And Brian and I have done a lot of tasting of just about all the grasses out here. And almost always, if in a book it says that it's good for an animal to eat, it actually tastes quite sweet and nice to us, which is very different from, for example, that three-horn. Now, Olivia, of course, we've just come out of a horrible drought, as was mentioned earlier, and you say, what do the animals eat when the grass all dries out? Well, come and have a look over here. Now, if we look down over here, What you can see is that the grass is very sparsely dispersed. So here it is, and then there's a huge gap in between. Now what happens during a drought or during the winter time, remember we have no rain here during the winter at all. What happens is this grass goes very dry, but because the animals have lived here for millions and millions of years, they've developed the ability to deal with it. So the grass is brown, and to you and I, it looks like there's nothing at all to eat. But the animals manage to survive, except in a very bad drought like we've just had. And we've had lots of animals that have really suffered as a result because they can't find enough to eat. So although to you and I, it looks like this is good grazing, it's good food to eat, it is good food to eat, but during the winter time when everything goes brown and grey here, it's still actually not too bad for the animals like the buffalo and sometimes the impala, for example, which move from eating grass to eating the leaves off trees, and that's called browsing. That's a really good question. But we must remember, of course, that all the animals out here have managed to develop strategies to survive in these conditions. Now, Grace, you want to know how long droughts normally last, and I think it was Liliana, you want to know when it started. Well, you see, a drought's a difficult thing to talk about or to define exactly when it starts. It's difficult to say whether it started. You see, what we have here, just let me take it back, is a summertime when there's rain, then in wintertime there's no rain at all. Then if you have the next summertime after the dry season that has no rain, then you have a drought. So that's what we had last time. So we had the dry winter season of 2015. Then we had the summer season, say between September and March of 2016. There was no rain then either. Then we had another dry season between the winter of, so for the winter of 2016, so between say May and September of 2016, and only then did it rain. So I suppose you might say that the drought was almost a year. So a drought would have started here, I suppose, after the summer rains didn't come around November 2015, and then the drought would have broken, well, only about a month ago in October of 2016. So that's probably the best answer I can give you on that one. Now we're going to keep trying desperately to find a woodland kingfisher. I just want to see if you can hear it there. No, all you can hear is the wind. But Brent Leo Smith has got something very interesting to show you.
Well, fortunately, our search seems to be going a little bit better. As I said, I was looking for three big male lions. I haven't found three big male lions, unfortunately. I've found two. So I'm sure the third one is probably lying in some shade close by. We just can't see him at the moment. So there we go. So these are the big daddy lions. And you can see they've got very full tummies. They ate a whole baby or a young buffalo last night. And now they're resting in the shade. They came for a drink at a little water hole. And then they've just moved beyond into a little dip where there was some shade to rest up. Hello, Sunia. Sunia would like to know, are the lions protected from hunters? Indeed they are, Sunia. There's no hunting allowed in 8.5 million acres. Isn't that amazing? A massive area that's protected. No animals are allowed to be hunted within that area. So there we go. Isn't that wonderful? So they are very protected. When they die, they normally die from natural causes, which in lion life means they're normally killed by another male lion. Hi, Olivia. Olivia would like to know, why do lions hunt at night? Well, there's a couple of reasons, Olivia. Well, number one is it's cooler and they're able to move around better when it's cooler. As you can see, when it's hot, they don't move too much at all. Number two, their eyesight is designed to hunt at night. So they've got much better eyesight at night than we do, but about 8 times what we can see at night. And also better eyesight than all the antelope, impala and zebra, well, that's not an antelope, but all the animals that they hunt, they can see better. So it gives them some cover, and the cover of darkness, as well as the fact that it's cool enough that they're able to move for extended periods. Now, a big male lion's paw is about the size of a side plate, and they're incredibly strong animals. These guys probably weigh around 400 pounds, and they've got that big fluffy mane around their neck. Now, the females, which you've seen with Byron, don't have that, and that's because the females don't fight as often as the males, and that big fluffy hair is to protect their throat and back of their neck, the vulnerable areas if they get into a fight. Oh, he's tired, he's gonna roll over. Anna Grace is wondering, what is the predator of lions? Anna Grace, other lions are the biggest killer of lions, particularly male lions, and groups of male lions, when they're young, they move through, and if they want to take over an area, they'll kill other lions, females and males. And these guys, when they did, they came through, they killed a bunch of cubs, as well as three or four adult females, before they calmed down and became the kings of the prides in this area. So there's four of them, even though we can only see two at the moment, and they defend an area together. And these four lions have three different prides. So the one pride you've already seen, which is the Nkahuma pride with Byron, and then they have a Styx pride, which is to the east of, or southeast of us, and the Torchwood pride, which is to the east of us. So they will move between the different prides, unless, and they often move without seeing the lionesses for quite some time. And if they hear another male lion start roaring in the north, then all four of them will rush there to go defend their territory together. Now, that's why coalitions are so important for lions. So if there's four of you, you've got a better chance of being able to keep an area for longer. Now, also, a lot of people think male lions don't hunt. Of course they do. They spend so much time away from the females. And while they're away from the ladies, they've got to hunt for themselves. Generally, they'll hunt quite big things like buffalo and giraffe, hippo. Now, Gage is wondering why only the males have names. Well, at the moment, Gage, the males have sort of very distinguishable characteristics that a lot of the lionesses don't have. Now, that male lying on his back, his name is Dino. The tooth, you can't really see on his right-hand side, he's got a scar that lets you see his tooth, and it was from a fight. Now, the other male lying there, now, we haven't seen these guys, two of them, for quite a while, and I'm not sure who this one is. He's either Nena, the warrior, or Tsugu Gold from his golden mane. Who do you think it is, Vim? I don't know either. Yes, I'm not sure which one this is. Especially when they're lying down flat like that, it's quite difficult to see. I'm trying to see his ears. So how we identify different lions is from scars and quite often nicks in the ear. And the way he's lying at the moment, I can't really see his ears too clearly or any nicks or scratches or scars. And the one difficult thing about scars is male lions are constantly adding to their scars. They're always fighting, quite often with each other over girlfriends or over food. So, as I was just saying, Liliana, that the males often spend quite a bit of time away from the family because they've got to protect the family from other lions, and they've got more than one family. These lions have three families they have to protect, so they move between the different families. So, sometimes they're with the families, sometimes they're not. But we're going to sit here, and hopefully we can find the other two lions that are missing. And if we can't, we'll just have a look at these two. While we do that, let's go back to Byron, who's with the Nkahuma and cubs.
And we've managed to find the rest of the lions, everyone. And the females, all four females, and the rest of the cubs. Some of them have just moved now, but we've got two beautiful females here with the one cub. It looks like this cub's trying to suckle a little bit, trying to get some milk from the mother. It's still very, very hot, so they're staying in the shade. But the other lioness and some of the cubs moved to that area where we first saw the two little cubs. So I might, we're just going to sit here a little bit and see, maybe these lions get up and move too. And the little male cubs don't have manes yet, like those big males that Brent has found. It's only when they get older, so from around the age of about, or from 2 years old already, you can start seeing little bits of hair growing around the neck, but it won't be nearly as big as those big males that Brent has got. And usually from the age of about 4 or 5 years old, you'll start seeing the mane getting very, very big. And then the older they get, it does get a bit bigger and a bit thicker. But only from about 4 or 5 years old is when you start seeing those big manes. So not yet. These little cubs are still far too young to have big manes. It's very difficult to say how many lions are in a pride, usually, because pride sizes can vary and be very, very different. Now, this pride, as we said, there are 4 lionesses and 6 cubs, and look, here come the other cubs now. They're coming back to these females. Ah, look at that, rubbing up against them. Wonderful. So Chris, some prides I've seen 3 lions together, some prides I've seen 15 or 20 lions together. That's a very, very big pride. So it varies, all depends on the area that they are in, how successful they are, how much food is around, all of that. So there's no exact answer as to how many lions are usually in a pride. Can hear that. Oh, let's just stop now. That woodland kingfisher that James said we must listen out for. We'll see if we can hear it again. Maybe it calls. I can't see it. They're very secretive little birds. Davion, you want to know about the lion roar, and is it instinct or is it learnt behavior? It most certainly is instinct. I think lion roars are instinct. They do learn it, obviously, from adults when they, and I've seen it before with a whole pride, males, females, and little cubs trying to roar before. I've seen that once before. Very, very interesting. But so they do probably learn it a little bit from the females, from the adults, when there is. Or when they are all together, but it is instinct. They know that they have to roar, and they know how to roar. Obviously, when they're young like this, they don't roar nearly as loudly as these big lion, these females do, all those big males. But when they get older and bigger, that roar will be very, very loud. So, Owen, you want to know why do we call a group of lions a pride and not a pack? So, Owen, a pack, or the word pack, is usually referred to animals like dogs. So, a group of dogs, or any canine species, and that's the family that dogs belong to. They are known as pack animals. So, in this area, we have African wild dogs, and they are referred to as a pack. Also, if you have, if you perhaps have maybe jackal, it's often a pack of jackals if there are a few of them around. But the cats, because they are big cats, part of the feline family, and I'm not exactly sure where the name pride comes from, but that is the term given to lions specifically, not other cats. So it's only lions, big groups of lions, because they are social animals and you always find them in big family groups. Sure, it's very, very hot out here at the moment. The lions are clever, they're in the shade, but they've left no shade for us. Cash, you'd like to know, is there a queen lion? Because often you've heard the term that the males are the kings of the jungle, or the king of the jungle. Now, I wonder about that, and maybe you can all think about this. So technically, there isn't a term for the queen lion. We don't use that term. But the lions, the male lions have been known as the king of the jungle for a long time, before we were even around. But I wonder, and I'll tell you why. So think about this. We've seen, and I've seen many times, where lions are lying around and or perhaps on the move, and they bump into elephants. And elephants are very, very big and powerful. And I've seen elephants chase lions away. So I wonder who is actually the king of the jungle, if it might actually be the elephant. At least there's a bit of movement from these lions. Leah and Cora, you want to know if the lions migrate to follow their prey. So, Leah, in these areas where we are, and now we are in South Africa, right down the southern part of Africa, these lions do not migrate. They are here all year round, even in the winter. And the reason for that is the animals that they feed on are also here all year round. They do not move, and they do not migrate. You might know some animals up in East Africa. You get migrations of zebra and wildebeest up in those areas in Kenya and Tanzania, because they need to follow where the food is and where the water is. Whereas these lions, because there's generally food and water throughout the year, even in winter down in these parts of Africa, they don't have to migrate. So no, they will not migrate at all. They don't have to follow their prey. There will always be food around for them. Alexis, you want to know if female lions are calmer than the male lions? Now, it depends. I think if you had to get too close to these little cubs, no, they won't be calm at all. They'll be very aggressive. But generally speaking, the males are a bit more aggressive. They are more powerful than the females, and they can be aggressive, especially when they get to a kill. If there's food for them, they fight amongst themselves to feed on the best food. But these females will definitely be quite aggressive too if you do threaten them. All right, we're going to see what these lions do if they move around some more. But while I do that, let's head back to James, who's on a big tree trunk.
I'm on a big tree and I'm standing like Rafiki. But it doesn't very comfortable, unless you're a baboon like he was. Now, we've come into this area because we heard some kudu alarm calling. Our kudu is a very large antelope, and it goes bah, bah, when it sees something dangerous like a predator. Now, we think the predator is somewhere up here. And so I've stepped onto this tree to look and see if we can't spot something. Now, you might be asking yourself, is it not dangerous to be out here? Well, it's a little bit dangerous, but it's the same as if you had to go to a very big city and you didn't understand how cars worked, for example, then it would be dangerous if you tried to cross a road. But here, because we've been trained and because we're with a man like Aubrey, who has been here for so many years, it's not that dangerous. So what we do is we walk very carefully and we carry on and we see if we can't find some tracks which would be the footprints of whatever predator it is that the kudu alarm called at. And the other thing we do, you see this here, we just check which way the wind is blowing. See that? So the wind is blowing very well for us. It's blowing across us like that, so if there's a predator there, it won't smell us coming. Now, Jessica, while we walk looking for this predator, we're going to talk quite quietly, and we'll carry on. Oh, Aubrey's actually spotted the kudu. There's the kudu there. You see it there, Brian? Now, that kudu was looking the other way. So we don't know exactly what it was looking at. Could have been a leopard, could have been another lion, but because lions are territorial, in other words, they tend to spend time in the same area, it's much more likely that it's a leopard that's gone walking past this kudu on the hunt. They tend to move more in the day, and the kudu's got a fright, and it's gone bah, bah, which is just sort of shouting and telling all its friends, I've seen something, and it's also telling the predator, I've seen you, move along. Now, as we move along, you want to know how far we walk in a day. It really does depend on what we see. So we have walked thus far probably about 2 miles so far. I don't think we probably won't walk more than 4 miles today, but sometimes we can walk up to 8 miles. Gavin, you ask a very good question. You say, why am I carrying the stick? Gavin, it's simply because I like to carry a stick in the bush. There's no other reason for it. I was looking for a stick. I had a very nice stick that Brent gave me, and then I broke that one. And Aubrey found me this stick today. So this is my new stick, and hopefully I'll be able to keep it. I just like to use it to point with, to sort of hit Brian when he's not behaving. You see, because he's much bigger than me, so I need to be able to hit him. That's not very true. I just like to walk with a stick. Oh, look here. Look what Aubrey's found here. Yingwe. I'm just asking Aubrey what he thinks has happened here. Sheen. Yeah. Right, what we have here, everybody, we think, is signs that a leopard has climbed at the tree. So what it does is it sticks its claws in like that, and then climbs up, just like your house cats will be able to do. And they climb up, but because this is a marula tree, you can see the bark comes off. It flicks off. And so with the big claws of the leopard go in like that, and maybe in like that, and up it goes. And there's definitely no leopard in the top of the trees there, Brian. No. No leopard in the top of this tree. So we think maybe that this is quite old damage. We don't think this is very new, but that's probably what pulled the bark off the tree. Isn't that very cool? A leopard, of course, is this prince of cats, if you like. We're talking about the king of the jungle. I agree with Byron that the real king of the elephants, or the real royalty is the elephants, but the real prince is the leopard. And that's what we're hoping to find right now. Now, Hayley, while we walk along here, you want to know if there's anything we can do about the drought to save water. Well, you know, interestingly, Caled, not Hayley. I'm not sure where I got Hayley from. Caled, it's an interesting one because you know what? Out here, Caleb, yes, that's what I said, I think. Caleb, the big thing about saving water, interestingly, is that it's normally people who live in cities who are able to do much more about a drought than we can out here, for example. So here, we take a bit of water out of the ground, but remember, we don't wash cars, we don't have baths, we've got showers, of course, we don't have swimming pools, we don't have, say, 2 or 3 bathrooms per house. So it's people in cities who use much more water than people who live in areas like this. And so it's actually people in cities who have to take take much more responsibility for the water that they use than we do out here. Yes, we have to be very careful. We make sure that we don't waste water, that our taps don't run, that our toilets don't run and that sort of thing, and that we don't waste water with things like too much washing and that sort of stuff. But it's when you go to the cities, when you've got to clean the house, you've got two or three flush toilets, you've got two or three sinks that clean things, you've got a washing machine, you've got a hose pipe in the garden that's watering the garden, you've got a swimming pool, like I said, that sort of thing really does waste a lot of water. And so that's where you've got to be really very careful about how much water you use. Very, very good question, Caleb. Now, we haven't found any more tracks of this leopard, but we might be lucky. So we'll just keep walking and see what else we can find as we go. Vijay, you're going to answer this question for yourself. You say, why do the kudu shout when they see a predator? Well, Vijay, what do you do? Tell me something. If you're on the playground, right, and a bigger kid comes up to you and you feel scared by that bigger kid, what do? If you want to know that you want him to go away, what do? You shout at him, of course. And then also by shouting, what you do is you attract the attention of your friends. And so your friends will look too and they'll come and maybe they'll stand next to you and the big kid who wants to be nasty to you will go away. It's a little bit the same. That's exactly what a kudu does when it feels afraid. It shouts to say, hey, I see you, go away, go away, go away, leave me alone, go away. And that's what it's doing. I'm hoping to find some kind of interesting antelope to show you. Oh, Anaya, you say, are the animals running free? Anaya, we are sitting in 8.5 million acres of wildlife land, okay? That's three times the size, if I'm not mistaken, of Yellowstone National Park. It's our massive area. It's not a plantation. There's no fence here. We don't know what we're going to see around the next bush. So it really is, all the animals are completely free and wild over here. Let's have a look at this plant here. In fact, no, let's not look at that plant. Let's look at this, because to many of you, this will be quite familiar. What we have here is a whole lot of dung. Now, dung, of course, in anyone else's language is poo. And this particular poo is very well aged. Smells very good.
A fine vintage.
It smells a little bit like spices mixed with mushrooms. Now, come and have a look a little bit closer. And what this is zebra dung. So a zebra has come along here, and many of you who have ridden horses or seen horses on farms will know that that's exactly what a horse's dung looks like when it gets a bit old, and that's what that is. See? And it smells actually very nice because it's just grass. Beautiful. Now, to Corporate Landing and Trantwood Elementary. It's been wonderful having you with us. We're going to continue hopefully looking for this leopard. And in the meantime, we hope that you have a wonderful day, the rest of your day at school. Enjoy your school days and we'll hopefully see you on safari again very soon.
Welcome back to all our regular viewers. As we can see, we're still with those two Birmingham boys, and we decided to do what they were doing. We got really hot over there, so we found ourselves our own little spot of shade. Now, as you can see, there are Mfumo and Amber Eyes are around here somewhere, but it is a very thick area behind where we are, so quite difficult to see where they are. I don't think there's going to be much action here for the next while. So I think we're going to leave at the Birmingham boys. Now, can anyone tell me who the Birmingham boy on the right is? I do not know whether it's Nena or Mtsogo. I look at his ears. I can't see any distinguishing marks. And I haven't seen these lions in so long. Now, the problem is he had that equal sign across his nose if it was Nena. But those type of scars change so regularly, so if anyone can tell me who it is, I would be most appreciative. Remember, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you do that. Okay, so as I said, not much happening here. They're going to be fast asleep for the next little while. Maybe we'll come back here later. I still think Queen Karula's around somewhere, so definitely worth having a look. So while we leave these sleeping lions, I'm sure, hopefully, Byron's lions are a little bit more active.
Now, these lions are not quite sleeping, everyone. They are just cleaning and grooming themselves. The cubs have been quite active, moving backwards and forwards between the different females and around in the shade. But they are still fairly settled, I think, because it is still so hot. I think all that's happened is they've split up a little bit. Some are lying about 30 or 40 meters behind us, and then a few of them are lying right here next to us. The flies are probably bothering them quite a bit too. You could see that little cub, just like we saw, I mean, yesterday afternoon we saw that Birmingham male who was out in the clearing, and geez, the flies would not leave him alone. It's cleaning their paws. I wonder why they would be doing that now, because, I mean, I don't know when last they had a kill, but lions generally groom themselves quite regularly. Maybe try and get little ticks that might be sitting around those paws with them walking through the long grass. That's potentially what they're trying to do. You can see this lioness is actually trying to bite, use her teeth to clean, so there might be something in there, fleas or ticks, that she's trying to get out. Dara, interesting question, and you wanted to know if a little cub is born with a hearing problem or an eyesight problem, does the pride abandon it? So, usually, see, I don't really know, and I'll tell you why, is because all the cubs that I've seen, so, okay, let's start from the beginning. Actually, hang on, this one lioness is up. Let's just have a look. I'll get back to your question now, Dara. Let's just see what these lions do. I might just change position and lie in the shade there again. So Dora, what happens is, let's look at the beginning now. When lions give birth to cubs, so the first few weeks of these little cubs' lives, they are in a den site. They are completely helpless. They rely solely on the female to come back and allow them to suckle from them. So what happens is, now I'm trying to think now, it's about a month and a half to 2 months before those cubs are brought out of the den site. She may move the den site slightly, but she will carry those cubs to a new den site, but not far from the original den site. But what happens then is, when she does decide to now move the cubs, usually the weaker ones, the ones that probably can't see or probably can't hear, when she arrives back and she contact calls for them to come out and suckle them, if those cubs are not able to get food or get milk and suckle from the female, they won't survive anyway. So it's a case of them not surviving rather than a case of them being abandoned. I think because a lot of the time we don't see that. When they young and they're in the den, you very seldom see these little cubs unless they get brought out into an open, or perhaps onto the rocky outcrop where they might be hiding, or in a thicket out of the thicket where they might be in a den around there. So I think it's more of a case of them just not getting enough food, rather than a case of them being abandoned. And I think that is usually what happens, and the strongest cubs will survive, the weak ones will not. And that again is survival of the fittest out here, and that's how nature maintains a balance, with the healthy animals surviving and the weaker or animals that won't survive potentially are going to die. Now, these lions, to be honest, I don't think they're going to move anytime soon. Even though their heads are up, it's very, very warm. I mean, I could be mistaken, and it's always a tough call if they're going to move or not. Trevor, you wanted to know if the lions are immune or other animals are immune to tick bite fever. I've never seen or heard of lions contracting tick bite fever. They do build up an immunity to the ticks to an extent. Some animals, if the ticks really infest them completely, they can suffer some serious damage from the ticks rather than an actual tick bite fever like we contract from ticks. But I've never seen lions be harmed by ticks or anything like that. All the animals get them, they build up an immunity. And it usually doesn't affect them like it affects us. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to leave these lions. I don't think they're going to move anytime soon. It's still very, very warm. They're enjoying the shade. There's a bit of a cool breeze here. So I'm going to move out. We can potentially try and come back later, or maybe also try for those males a bit later, depending where Brent is. But while we do that, let's head back to James. It's great to have James back, and see what little creature he has got for us.
This is not easy, everybody. There's a butterfly here, a gorgeous butterfly called the yellow pansy. Have you got it, Brian?
I do.
Isn't he wonderful? Or she? Now, I'm going to teach you a word in Xitsonga or Shangaan, and it's one of my favorite Shangaan words, and that is the word paparati, which means butterfly or moth. Paparati. This is a very irritating form of paparati. Here it is, Brian. It's just behind us here on the road, next to that giant pile of dung. Brian is doing an exceptional job, just back from leave. Can you see it there? There we are. And of course, the reason that it's totally invisible when it folds its wings is a very clever sort of anti-predation strategy. So it opens its wings. I'm not sure. I mean, I assume it's coloured like that in order to attract a mate. But that's actually rubbish. I'm not sure why it should be coloured like that, of course, because its mate is exactly the same colour. But it does fold its wings completely. Here we go. And when it does that, of course, it becomes invisible. Now, it's amazing. You know, you come out here. I've been wandering about these lands for the last 15 years or so. That sounds very romantic, doesn't it? Wandering these lands for the last 15 years. But I've never asked myself the following question. Why should it be that butterflies are colourful? And in much the same way as I've yet to hear a valid argument for why it is that both sexes of the lilac-breasted roller are colourful, I'm not sure that I know why butterflies are colourful. It cannot be to attract mates, because they're both the same colour as each other. So I really don't know. Any ideas, Judy H? Well, I've been away for a while, which means that your need to school me has been sort of reduced. Perhaps you could help out. Why is it anybody? Hashtags Fire Life, questions at wildearth.tv, terms and conditions apply, batteries not included. Tell us why you think butterflies perhaps are both male and female the same colour, and why they're so bright. In the case of something like a common diadem, or not a common diadem, in the case of a monarch butterfly, of course, that orange and black and white coloration is aposomatic. So it's supposed to be terrifying to predators, because it means that they are in fact toxic, that they're full of what are they called? Cardioglycosides, that really are very dangerous for the heart, and so that means that animals avoid them. Then in the case of the common diadem, which is a similar colour to the monarch, but of course it is totally harmless, so it's what we call Batesian mimicry. It's so it's mimicking the colour of a much more toxic animal. Well, that's why it's that colour. And in those two species, in the common diadem, the male is a completely different colour from the female, so that's quite easy to understand. But that thing isn't poisonous, I don't think. I don't think that that black and yellow coloration means anything necessarily from a predation point of view. So why it should be that color, I don't know. And while, of course, you consider this, I would like you to look at the injury that I have sustained on your behalf, everybody, in order to find you entertainment. Here I am, risking life and limb. You see that, Brian?
It's terrible.
It is terrible. And Brian says that I have a fight with sticks, of course, and he is right. I'm not very good with the sticks. But don't worry, we'll be okay. We'll make it all the way around. We're heading sort of towards Treehouse Dam now, and I don't want you to worry about me in the slightest. I'm okay. Okay, that's enough of that. Right. Okay. We gave up on trying to find those leopard tracks. We've sent Brent kind of around that area, and while he heads into that direction, let's find out if he's managed to find anything that was perhaps causing those kudus to shout.
Hello, well, we've left those sleepy male lions and we've taken James's advice. He's told us to check this area for a possible leopard. So that's what we're going to do. And hopefully, it is a queen karula, and hopefully she's got both cubs, but I'll accept any leopard for now. Nice to have the Nkuhumas back on the property, and nice to have three of the four Birmingham boys here as well. It's been a while since we've seen all four of them together. I know they were all four were together on Torchwood last week or the week before. So they still are a force to be reckoned with. They haven't split yet and they still do come together, which is a good sign for the strength of the coalition lasting longer. Oh, Franklin's. So this is the area James thinks we should check. Now I think Byron seems like he's had the same plan as me. The lions are going to be flat and lazy on this hot summer's day. And so he's gone off to find something else. And he's now found something he forgot to get out of its pajamas.
And look what we've managed to find already, a beautiful zebra. There was another one around here. But I'm not sure where it's moved off to. There's some impala. You might see them coming into frame. They're walking just behind that zebra at the moment. A bit difficult to see, a little bit off to in the thicket. There they are. One or two impala, but always nice to see zebra around. One thing we haven't seen, and people always ask me, what do guests usually ask for when they're on safari? Now, a zebra is one of them. People love seeing zebra because they're so strange, they're so different. And then the other animal is giraffe, and we haven't seen giraffe for quite some time. I'm not sure why it is. Perhaps they're all on holiday somewhere. We're not far from the gate, so a few vehicles driving past us, but these animals don't seem to be too fazed. Still feeding very happily over there. It's always nice to see zebra. Uh, Also just enjoying the trying to stay closer in between the thickets, under the shade of the trees around, or there's a little bit of shade around there, but they're not as reliant on shade as some of the predators are. You know, those predators love moving into the shade during the heat. And we're not too far from those lions, so there's impala and zebra, better be careful. But this area is quite open, and I think it would be difficult for the lions to hunt. Even though there are some trees around, it's fairly open. You can have a look. I mean, if you look at this terrain, it would be difficult for the lions to hide and stalk some of these animals out in the open. Perhaps, you never know, but maybe later when it gets a bit darker and a bit cooler. I doubt anytime soon. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to head towards Sydney's Dam. Going to go and have a look around there purely because it's hot, and I'd like to see if it filled up at all from that rain that we had last night. And then maybe we're lucky and we get some animals that are drinking around there or just moving through that area. There's a stench of buffalo in the air at the moment, maybe from the Nkuhuma Pride. We know they've been very successful with buffalo, but there've been a lot of buffalo carcasses around, and you can definitely smell it. While I head towards Sydney's Dam, let's head back to Brent and get an update on where he is.
Okay, well, no sign of anything just yet. We're just going very, very slowly through here, and hoping to spot some sign of a leopard. Some cloud cover coming in, bringing the temperature down a little bit. So we're going to check Rebecca's Road. Now that's where Byron found Karula last night, and who knows, maybe Rebecca's Road is going to be lucky two evenings in a row. Now, this is a great area for it to hunt. So you've got impala herds, and you've got nice thickets on the edge. So we can't see any impala, but there are a lot here, but they've got these lovely thickets that she can utilize while she's hunting. But we're going to keep checking very, very carefully, but it sounds like Commander Bond is on fire and found something very interesting.
I don't think I'm on fire. Are we on fire, Brian?
No.
It is quite hot though, isn't it?
Yes.
Now, on account of the heat, we've decided to show you something that Aubrey has just shown us. This is, of course, the baboon's tail, which many of you will know backwards by now. But what I didn't know is that actually we've spoken a lot about how the capillary action of this plant, so you can see that it's got very sort of thin tubes it's made of, and that sucks water out of the soil. But on a hot day like this, if we go to here, Brian, look over here where my hand is, if you pull that out, especially after there's been rain, that is edible. And it's quite moist. If you're thirsty and hungry after a long day in the bush, you can have a little bit of baboon's tail, and we'll give Brian some because he's, of course, doing most of the work out here. And just in case you're wondering, of course, Aubrey is on security detail. There you go, Brian. And, of course, he's also, as Herbert does, he's also on teaching detail for those of us who didn't grow up in this area. And it's a great joy to have him with us for the first time. Aubrey, of course, is a guide at Juma. And he's just helping out today. Herbert is currently driving, I think, some staff, because today was the Juma staff Christmas party. Oh. that's an interesting one from you about why butterflies should be coloured. You say maybe it's so that they can fool predators into believing that they're birds. Kat, I don't think that's the reason, because I think size would make a greater difference. And that's an interesting one because, of course, we know that moths often have what look like owl's eyes on their backs. And I think maybe they have those sort of owl's eyes in order to try and con predators into believing that they're something bigger than they really are. So that's possible. But I don't think so for a butterfly like that somehow. Now, here is a burrow. And I can only think that this was dug by Brian. Say it with me. An aardvark. And an aardvark, of course, an ant bear. A long-nosed, long-tongued, long-clawed anteater, roughly the size of 4.5 feet long, and really very, very powerfully built indeed. This one, of course, is not here anymore, and it's often thought that aardvark, wonderful word to say, like to eat only termites, but actually they eat a lot of ants, and I suspect that this here was an ant nest rather than a termite nest, because there doesn't seem to be any obvious termite activity here. But you can see he's dug in here. He probably spent the night here. He, the aardvark of this area, may well come around here and spend some more time here, sort of uses a temporary burrow, but at the moment is completely unoccupied. And we know that because there are no flies. Often you find a very specific kind of sort of browny, tawny fly that lives above the burrow if there's an aardvark inside. And of course, over here, if I leave a fresh footprint, you can see that's what a fresh footprint looks like over here. And there are none of those here other than mine and Brian's. Very nice. On we go. Now, we have failed to find, it's quite interesting, of course. Now, many of you will know that I've been away for a while, and we found something else to eat here. Hang on, I'll carry on with that thought. This is mbezana, and it's a ripe one. The first ripe one of the season that I found. Well, I haven't found it. Aubrey found it. Thank you, Aubrey. Now, do you want to share it? Okay. That's really not bad. That's actually quite nice. I've had these things before when they've been unripe and they are truly disgusting. Now this, of course, we've described as being your Sunday lunch of roast chicken and apple crumble and custard mixed together as one. And so it is. Vakumile, Kurula. They have found Kurula. I'm sure that's what that kudu was alarm calling at earlier. So Brent is there with the great queen. Let's go and find out how she is.
Well, there we go. Well, James and Aubrey did hear that alarm call in this area, and we were just behind Ephraim when he found Queen Kurula atop a termite mound on Rebecca's Road. So that's 2 days in a row we've managed to find Kurula in this area. Now, can't see how hungry she is or whether she's going to get moving again shortly, but the likelihood is that if we find her sitting out in the open like this, is that she hasn't made a kill. So it's possible. I know she was quite hungry yesterday. I'm sort of surprised she didn't manage to make a kill in the dark, stormy weather of last night. VM says she looks full. You were with Byron last night, didn't you? You saw her. No, I can't remember who was. No, you were with me yesterday. It was Khat, so we're not sure. I didn't see her yesterday, but we'll see when she gets up. Maybe she's snacked on a baby impala, but not enough to call the cubs in. It doesn't seem like there's any carcass around here, and from where the kudu were alarm calling earlier, she's obviously been on the move. Now, it's quite interesting. As the cubs have become older, we have started seeing her more and more on Juma again, whereas when they were younger, she spent a lot of time to the south of our boundary. There you go, you can see those impressive markings on the Queen of Juma. for a leopard of her age, she's in incredibly good condition. And if you look at her ears, just a little bit of tattering starting from all the different bites from those evil stable flies. Oh, she's got a big tick in her ear today. That looks nearly full, so it'll probably drop off soon. But you see those tiny little flies that cause her ears to flick are called stable flies. So the same species or family of flies that attacks domestic dogs and horses. They look very similar to the common house fly, apart from the fact they're evil little bloodsuckers. They occasionally feed on us as well while we out chat. Now, they can cause some problems for big cats. It's never been recorded in South Africa, but lions in Kenya and Tanzania have got serious emancipation problems from a massive infestation of stable flies, which, I mean, they cover nearly their whole body. And in the Ngorongoro crater in the 60s, and it caused the lion population to drop from 75 to 60. And not all of them died. A lot of them just moved away because the flies were so incessant. There she is. Well, great to catch up with Karula for the second day in the row, and it seems like everyone out there has started our second cat streak. We're on day two. Can we get to that magical 90 days? We nearly got there this time, but 3 months of cats every day. I think the summer months are going to prove to be slightly more difficult to produce that. But you know what? We're up for a challenge. So Karula does move quite a bit during the day and in the heat, which is, well, not unusual, but uncommon for a leopard. Now, you'll notice that a lot of literature, especially older literature on leopards, say they don't move around that much during the day. And that is true for areas where they're heavily persecuted, heavily hunted, or have a lot of conflict with people. But in areas where they're completely protected, you'll notice that quite a few of the leopards will move around any time of the day, and Karula seems to do it a lot. And she also hunts quite a lot during the hot time of the day. And it is quite a good strategy if you're a small leopard like Karula, because you immediately avoid conflict with things like lions and hyenas and male leopards. But hopefully she's going to be on the move and on the hunt a little later. Now, there's a lot of impala around here, a lot of baby impala as well. So you probably find she is going to focus her efforts on those at the moment. And it sometimes makes our life a bit difficult, because when she does catch one, she doesn't leave a nice drag mark for us to follow. And of course, after the rain, the ground is quite hard. So again, tracking is very difficult. But that's where another set of tracking skills comes in. That's where your ears come in, listening for those alarm calls, not only from the big things like kudu, but also from little things like cisticulas and waxbills. They can often lead you to incredible sightings. But while Karula sits atop her termite mound, and while we wait for her to get moving, Byron has got a bird that's ready to pop.
And that is a fantastic find by Brent. I'm so glad he got to find Karula. He was looking yesterday, and it's so great to see her up on a termite mound. Now, we have found a very interesting little bird, a black-bellied bustard. But it's not often we get so close to one. It's very close to the vehicle, and we've got such a nice view of it. I'm going to see if I can try get it to call for us. Maybe if I try my black-bellied bustard call, it replies. I'm not sure. How's that, everyone? It sounds just like a black-bellied bustard, don't you think? I wonder if the bird thinks so. Well, it hasn't moved off, so maybe it's just curious. but look at that beautiful eye and those beautiful markings around the head. Let's see if it calls for us. Come on. Have a look. It's extending its neck. Is it just going to move? Is it going to call? It's just moving very, very slowly, but let's stay with it. Let's see. Come on. Go past that bush branch. There we go. Watch. There we go. Oh, fantastic. Fantastic. Perhaps it was replying to me. This is obviously his territory, and I shouldn't hang around. Maybe not. Maybe not. I don't think my call was that good. Wonderful to see it. And to be so close to it. Usually they do move off fairly quickly. This one seems nice and relaxed for us. What a lovely sighting. So earlier I said I was going to go past Sydney's dam and just have a look, and there was actually very little water in there. It didn't look like the rain did anything for the dam. And there were no animals around either. So we just continued on. It's such a fascinating call. Wonderful little display with its neck. And that is purely a territorial call. And perhaps trying to attract the female. Beautiful bird. And speaking of beautiful birds, one has just landed off to our left. Don't know, Jandre, if you'd like to try and see it while the black-bellied bustard moves off. It's a beautiful view of the lilac-breasted roller. It's just off to our left, sitting on a branch just below here at the bottom. There we go. Let's see if it stays there for us. Stay. There we go. Now, I know a lot of our viewers do enjoy the lilac-breasted roller, and that's a beautiful view of one. And as I say that, it turns its back. You can still hear the little bustard next to the vehicle. And please remember, everyone, it's bustard, B-U-S-T-A-R-D, the bustard. Promise I'm not swearing on live of a live internet show. It's a lovely view. You can count the colors on the lilac breasted. Oh, there. Oh, hang on. Oh. Well, it flew. Just wonder what it went to do. It's just actually on this very large tree to our left, the terminalia. It's on the other side of the stem. Wonder what it's doing there. I wonder what it was doing there. I wonder if that hasn't perhaps got a little nest in there somewhere. Can't see it anymore. It's just disappeared behind the tree. Now we're going to continue and see what else we can find. While I do that, James is snacking this afternoon.
Now, we're often asked, of course, how could you survive out here if you were left alone? Perhaps you were in some sort of a Star Trek accident where you were beamed into this area by mistake without any form of help whatsoever. Could you survive? And my answer is always, at certain times of the year, yes. At other times of the year, if you couldn't hunt, absolutely not. Now, over here, this is one of the times of the year, of course, where there is some stuff around. I've just shown you the edible mbezana, or perdipus, which of course means the horse's urine tree. This is the snow white berry bush, Flugia verosa, or umhlangazi in Shangaan. Now, I've eaten one already, which means I'm going to give this one to Brian. Brian, there you are.
Thank you, sir.
Very delicious.
Wonderful.
What does it taste like, Brian? Like a very sweet. Brian's face is not very impressed, I must tell you.
Not that delicious, this one.
No, that's pretty good. Tastes like a very sweet kind of a pea. So a pea you'd pull out of a pod, and a very sweet one. Let's try Brian with one more, because this one's probably a little bit riper. There you are.
Thank you, sir.
Flugia verosa, if you'd like to speak Latin. You'd like to speak Latin, Brian?
Sometimes.
And then I did find a millipede in the middle of this bush somewhere.
That was better.
Is that nice? But the millipede seems to have absconded, right, as much as Karula did a little bit earlier for us. Shall we continue, Brian?
Yes,
sir. Oh, one more thing around here. I just want to show you. Is this beautiful inflorescence here? Now, this is the inflorescence of Panicum maximum, or buffalo, not guinea grass. There was a rather nasty pip there. Guinea grass is an excellent grazing grass, but only grows in the shade. And so you'll find, remember how often we've seen buffalo going snuffling around at the bottom of bushes like this, and they kind of stick their noses underneath and they take this grass over here, that sort of thing there. That's what they're going for. It's this guinea grass, which has got a gorgeous purple coloured seed. I don't know why it's called guinea grass, and it's actually very sweet to eat in the summer. And summer, of course, it is. And Brian, how do we know it's summer?
Because the woodland kingfisher is chirping away.
Oh, well, how does it chirp, Brian?
Chirp.
Very good. Hang on a second. Aubrey's found something else. Ah. Score. Aubrey is now collecting. Oh, look. He's doing this very carefully. Look at the spider. You see it, Brian? Now, I am very nervous of doing this sort of thing because I'm inexperienced. Now, look how gently Aubrey's doing it. And he's just coaxing it out. He's not pulling it out. He's just coaxing it gently out. This is a baboon spider. And just encouraging it to come out on its own. And of course, the danger is if you actually pull them out, you can harm them. But just by coaxing it gently like this, you can see that amazing colour as the sun shines on it. This is a big baboon spider. And of course, to many of you, this is of course the tarantula. That is so fantastic. Isn't that wonderful? Now, this tarantula, of course, has built its nest in a completely ridiculously stupid spot because it's in the middle of a road. And once they, if the hole is damaged ever, what happens is that they're sometimes very, they're almost completely unable to dig another hole. Because once they've dug the hole, the piece of equipment that they have, I forget on exactly which leg it is, it's like a little claw that helps them to dig. But by the time they've dug their burrow, that thing has gone away. It's worn down completely. And so they can't dig another burrow. And so we're very careful not to harm the hole in any way. But of course, if a car drives over this, well, it's going to be quite difficult. I don't believe a car hasn't driven over this, so perhaps she's still got her sort of digging implements and she's able to dig her hole. Isn't that wonderful? And Rachel, you think this is a very pretty spider. I have to agree with you. I think that they are gorgeous. And you know what? You can make them sit on your hand. I think it's probably a bit warm for them to be sitting on the hand now because they're a little bit too active. But you can make them sit on your hand and they've got the most gorgeous colours. There we go. Holding on there. Oh, so wonderful. Anyway, let's leave that one. Isn't that cool? That is wonderful stuff. I have never ever managed to get one out of the hole in that fashion, and that of course is the joy of experience. Very gentle touching with exactly the right kind of stick got the baboon spider or tarantula out of its hole. Isn't that wonderful? All right, Brent is still with the great queen. She's about over there, so we'll hand you back that direction immediately.
Well, she hasn't moved a muscle. She's snoozing on top of that same termite mound we just saw her on. And it does look like she might have eaten something. I didn't see her last night, but apparently she was quite hungry. Now, I keep hearing Franklin alarm calling, and I'm wondering whether the cubs aren't around here as well. I wonder. Can you say that? Franklin is very upset, and I doubt it's about Karula. Could also just be a passing slender mongoose. But having two young cubs, she's got to hunt constantly. Well, not so little anymore, and they're two big bellies to feed. Now, if we come out wide, Vim, you can see exactly where we are in comparison. There's quarantine over there, so we know there's lots of baby impalas in that area. But again, it's going to be quite difficult out on that big open area. She needs to catch them on the edge of the thickets. She's breathing quite heavily, not that heavily though. Looks very comfortable on top of that termite mound. But if anything, she might still move. So we're not going anywhere. We're going to stick right here with her. Hopefully she goes hunting. Growling and trying to bite the flies that are biting him. She is still alert, she is looking around. Remember, this is 100% live, so we never know whether an impala or something else might wander in and she might go into stalk mode. Remember, if you want to ask any questions, hashtag Safari Live or questions@wildearth.tv on email. That's still nice and toasty. But as I said, Karula isn't adverse to moving in the heat. Can hear impala playing, and that's what she's listening to. I could actually see them running in the distance. That's where she's watching. Now those impala are far away on quarantine. Yawn. Oh, it looks like, I thought she might lie down and get a bit more comfortable, but the flies might push her to move. Oh, it's so wonderful. I mean, this beautiful light in this afternoon that's going to come. If she moves off out of the shade, you guys are going to get the most spectacular screenshots. I mean, absolutely golden light here today. Remember to share those screenshots with us. And on our Facebook page or on Twitter with the hashtag Safari Live. What's that on her neck there, Vim? You see that? Oh, no, I think it's just a burr. A little bit higher? What is that? Something just stuck to her. Oh, yes, it's a burr. It's amazing that in ancient Greek, a leopard was believed to be a mixture between, a cross between a lion and a tiger. Now, guys, I'm wondering what a burr is. It's just a thorny or furry grass or plant seed that gets stuck on to animals' coats. I'm sorry, taxi's trying to get you. Go, tax. Oh, she's turned now. She's looking back to the north again. Now, those Franklin are still making an alarm call. I wonder if she doesn't have a kill close to here and she's just taking a timeout from the cubs. Franklin has been alarm calling every 5 or 6 minutes since we've been here. And strange enough, leopards were one of the first animals to be classified under the Linnaeus system, under the modern system of biological classification, in 1758. But it's changed a bit since then. All leopards and lions and all cats in those days were all felis, and till they discovered the difference in the hyoid apparatus and other things, and then the bigger cats became Panthera, and the others went to felis. Mary is wondering, is there any particular plant like citronella that the animals will rub itself on to keep the flies off? No, Mary, not that I know of. I've never seen them show that type of behavior ever, I'm afraid. They unfortunately don't know about that type of stuff. Now, another interesting thing, if we look back into a leopard's history, is that the last common ancestor for all the current big cats was, if I remember correctly, about 6.7 million years ago. I think that was too long. Sorry, 1 second. 6.3 million years ago. So the last common ancestor of lion, tiger, leopard, jaguar, and snow leopard. And the clouded leopard is believed to have emerged in Asia, so around 6.3 million years ago. And from there, the animals have diversified into those other different creatures. Now, even though a snow leopard is a leopard, it looks like from its historical ancestry that it's probably closer to a tiger. And out of the Panthera lineage, out of the ones we know, sort of lion and leopard, a leopard came into being probably quite a bit before lions did. But even still then, a leopard is relatively closely related to all the other big Panthera cats. But it's somewhere between a lion and a snow leopard. So the earliest thinking of a winter leopard evolved in Africa in its current form, like we're looking at now, is about 825,000 years ago. So lions are about 250 to 300,000 years ago, so quite a bit older than lions. And of course, leopards were spread throughout Europe as well. And they survived till about 24,000-25,000 years ago through a lot of Europe. Now, up until the sort of 1900s or maybe late 1800s, there were leopards that were said to survive in Turkey. They still survive in Turkey, but in Greece and in Portugal. But I think those are now completely extinct. Leopard densities and territories are sort of quite a very interesting thing that's always in flux, and it changes from time to time. And in this case, in the Sabi Sands, we've got relatively small leopard territories compared to other parts of Africa. In the northern Sabi Sands, though, we've got bigger territories than in the southern Sabi Sands. So in this area, your average female territory is around 1,000 hectares, and males 4,000 to 5,000 hectares. And if you go down to the Sand River, where there's higher density of Impala and Nyala in a smaller area, your female territories drop to about 400 to 600 hectares, and your male territories down to about 2,000 hectares. And Karula's actually got quite a big territory for a female leopard, probably 1,200, 1,300 hectares. But if we take, for example, Kalahari leopards or Cape leopards, their territories are massive in comparison. So one Cape leopard that lives up in the Cedarburg Mountains, who was collared, his territory is estimated to be 250,000 hectares. So what's that, four times the size of the whole Sabi Sands. Now that most of that is always to do with prey density. So we're blessed here in the Sabi Sands with high prey density, so they don't have to have massive territories to survive, and there's always available prey in the territories. Now in the deserts or in the mountain ranges, that's not always the case, and in a lot of cases in those extreme areas, leopards will eat a lot, have a much more varied diet, so a lot more things like scrub hares and rodents and termites and birds eggs, where there's an area like this, they're almost exclusively, their main source of protein always comes from small to medium sized antelope. Now I'm hoping Queen Karula does head off hunting at some point. But she deserves a rest. It's been a hot day and she has been moving around in the heat. So while we wait for her to get moving, let's go see what Commander Bond's up to on foot.
Now, I met an old man once who I think has probably popped his old clogs by now. And his name was Ian. Let's call him Ian. I've forgotten his surname. I had it and then it gone, because I'm also getting old now. Now, Ian, of course, was a tree expert and a great lover of Zululand, which is in the northern parts or northeastern parts of the country. No, it's not. It's on the eastern coast of the country. Anyway, what he used to do was grow grasses in his garden because he thought it was so beautiful. And I went to visit him once in his home in a place called Kloof, which is just to the west of Durban. And he had all sorts of grasses in his garden. He wouldn't plant any flowers that weren't from the area. And I just thought that was rather a good idea because, as you can see, this is rather a magnificent arrangement, isn't it, Brian?
It is.
Yes. Yeah, if I don't say so myself. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, we've looked at this one. That was the Aristida, or the Three Awn. Didn't taste very nice, but it is very beautiful. This is not a grass at all. It is a sedge, and it is known that it is a sedge. If we look at it like that, you can see it looks a little bit like a spring onion, I suppose. Can you see that, Brian?
No.
A little spring onion-ish, and it's not hot. It is actually hollow inside. It's like a sort of foam inside, as opposed to those capillary tubes that you'd find in a grass. And this thing is called the I'm actually not sure what its common name is. I think it's probably called bottle brush, but its botanical name is Cetaria sphacelata. There we go. And it's also got awns, like the three awn does, and that's to help the seeds disperse. And this, a love grass. A love grass, Brian.
Mm.
Yes, and there you can see
the sword teeth.
The sword teeth. I don't think it's the sword tooth loved grass because I think the seeds are a bit small, but you can see those things that are flapping there in the wind, everybody. These things here are in fact the anthers. That's where the pollen sits. And if you are a sneezer at grass, which Brian is, so we'll hold it away from him, that's what gets in your nose. It comes off there. It'll float off onto another grass like this, and it'll make these gorgeous seeds. Isn't that nice? Very nice. And you can make those into porridge if you have enough of them. Probably about 4 tons per 100 grams of porridge. And Steph apparently calls this a cat's tail. It is called a cat's tail. That's actually a much better term for it, but it is a Cetaria species. That's what it is in Latin. Very good grazing grass. Now, we're going to walk relatively quietly here because Karula is not far from where we are now. And we're hoping maybe we'll find a cub sitting on a termite mound. Because this, of course, is where Brent heard those Franklin's alarm calling. And when we came through here originally, when we heard that kudu alarming also around here, we thought we heard some Franklin's also around this area. So maybe we'll be lucky with the small spots of little Hosanna or little Shongile. Now, I thought it was rather clever question. While we just walk very slowly and gently up this road, looking into the trees and on the termite mounds and in the shadows of the trees, one of the kids today said, why is it that the male lion is known as the king of the jungle and the female lion is not known as the queen of the jungle? I thought that was a really perceptive question and an interesting one when we think about how we have named our leopards and our lions. And of course, it is unfortunately probably because we live in what we call a patriarchy, where certainly in this country, there's a, well, it's a very patriarchal society. So I thought that was a most clever question from that little kid who clearly isn't imbued with that social sense of patriarchy, and let's hope that that maintains. Brian, there's a hornbill flying by. Do you see it? Now, the reason I'm showing you that hornbill is not because it's the best hornbill sighting we've ever had in our lives, but simply because I saw a hornbill while I was in Thailand, Brian.
Oh, wonderful.
Yes. It was called an Oriental Pied Hornbill.
Hmm.
And it was pied, black and white, and found in the Orient.
Oh.
Ergo, an Oriental Pied Hornbill. Excellent. Hmm. I will post a picture of one once I figured out how to edit it into some functional form. Nobody else, of course, was very interested in the Oriental Pied Hornbill. Mostly they were interested in cocktails. Who can blame them? Right, Brian?
Yeah.
Yes. Anyway, it's so wonderful to be back here in the summer of Africa. And yes, it's hot, but it's got that wonderful feeling. I love this time of the year, probably from around about my birthday up until the end of December. It's just got a kind of momentum that starts to build around it. And I'm sure it's the same even where it's winter at the moment, of course, because for most, well, many people in the world, this is the holiday season. And even though, of course, we're not going to have huge holidays out here, it certainly feels as we're going towards that. Maybe that's just a throwback to my childhood. But the sound of the cicadas, the smell of the new grasses and those flowers and the feeling of that kind of close, wet air is just wonderful to me. It makes me think of Christmas and holidays and wonderful times with family and friends. And of course, my new family and friends in the Safari Live group. Now, we're going to just turn around here. There is a huge herd of impala and probably lots of little ones. Let's just walk up here quickly. Rebecca, you'll have to go again with that. Just walk. We're going to walk relatively quickly up here, everybody, simply because I haven't seen an impala lamb with you. I know you've seen many of them, and Brian and I saw two as we drove in today. But let's just, oh, there's one. I think underneath, you see where the tree has made an archway there? I think there's an impala lamb there. Is there?
Mm-hmm.
There is. Hooray! Brilliant stuff. Okay, we'll take a little stroll across quarantine, hopefully find a lamb or two while we do that. Let's head back to Baron, who has managed to relocate the lions who have been sleeping.
Now look what we've managed to find, everyone. A big male and a female lion. And I think this was the pair that Brent found this morning with the two other males. I know he did see them earlier and they moved off somewhere, but these two unfortunately have come out into the open, into the shade though. It is still very, very hot. And they are lying resting. The male was standing when we got here, when we found them, but he seems to have settled down again. But I'm hoping we get some activity out of them, maybe some more movement. And I'm not sure if they've been mating or not. I haven't seen anything yet, but it could be a possibility. I see something interesting running around, and it's quite quick, but usually you don't see them on the ground running around. Let's just see if Jean-Ré can get it. A spider hunting wasp. No, I lie, it's a tok-toki beetle, sorry. I think that's a tok-toki beetle. I don't know if it's got another name. Look how quick that little guy is, that's incredible. It's not a dung beetle. That is a tok-toki. Funny name, but incredible. Look at that. Actually, when it moved through some sun, I caught a bit of a sheen, and I thought it was a spider hunting wasp, but it's quite away from the vehicle. But it is so fast. Watch, it's heading right past the lions. That's incredible. Look at it go. Now, I'll explain why it's called a tok-toki beetle. And again, I haven't had a close look, but that does look like what it is. That is incredible. That is amazingly fast. Imagine how fast that is in proportion to its size. I mean, that is quick. That's very, very quick. Now, the tok-toki gets its name from a little display that it does and to attract a mate. The male runs around like that, and what he does is he'll stop and stand, and he actually taps the ground with his rear end. He'll go and he'll tap like this, and it's like tok-toki. Something like that, but it is what it does. Sorry, mate. I promise that is what it does. No, I think that's where it gets the name tok-toki. Luckily, we're watching lions now. Oh, dear. Anyway, so getting back to what we're actually doing here and watching lions. Alright, while we sit with these lions, James has found the bird he's been looking for all day. Let's have a look at it.
Hooray, there it is, everybody. And of course, I forgot when I was talking about the summer and the joys thereof. I forgot about the woodland kingfisher, which goes, Brian. There we are. You see, it looked up. It thinks Brian sounds exactly like a woodland kingfisher. What a wonderful, wonderful final sighting for the bushwalk this afternoon. Then we also had, over on the right-hand side, you can see some guinea fowl. Of course, the chickens of the bush, stringy as they are, even if you've casseroled them for days on end. And they're very peacefully sitting, and there's a northwesterly breeze blowing straight into our faces. And I'm going to ask Brian to sort of swing to the left-hand side, and just to give you an idea of what is, I think, a glorious evening starting to form here. And you can see that there is some kind of cloud bank moving in from the south, and it's just about to hide that wonderful African sun that is dipping slowly to the west, as inexorably as it must, of course. Gorgeous. And Brian, I'm going to ask you now, over there is a dead tree, It has been pushed over by an olifant, and then you can see the very top part of it. Just to the left of that, there's a grey-headed sparrow, I think, sitting on the edge there, and I bet that that grey-headed sparrow has got a nest in there, and I suspect that the grey-headed sparrow will sit in that tree until it's time to go down into his nest, where he will probably have a drink with his wife, shoot the breeze about how the day was, and check on the eggs that are no doubt incubating in the middle of that tree. What do you think, Brian? Do you think that's what's going to happen there?
Exactly what's going to happen.
I think so too. Now that, of course, is the first bird we're going to hear tomorrow morning going chip, 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 just before the crested Franklin gets in on the act with what a glorious afternoon. Right, come on, let's have a little stroll further across quarantine clearings here. See what else we can find. And apparently that's going to be it for the bushwalk today, everyone. We will see you in the morning, of course, bright and early. I'm not sure exactly what time the bushwalk will be at. I don't even know who's going to be on the bushwalk. So until then, it's been wonderful joining you again in the wilderness with Brian and his thumb. And we will talk to you tomorrow, probably from the vehicle, but who knows. Until then, stay safe and happy, and we'll hand you back over to Brent.
Welcome, Windsor Woods Elementary School. My name's Brent. I've got VM on camera, and we've got a surprise for you. It is our favourite female leopard. Her name is Karula, and she's on the hunt. Look at that. Isn't she absolutely beautiful? Now, she's hunting for small to medium-sized antelope, moving through the bush, moving from termite mound to termite mound, using it to, oopsie, sorry about my head, to get a good view up ahead. There's lots of impala and other animals in this area, so she's definitely on the hunt. She's got two babies to feed that are about 10 months old, and they eat a lot. Probably just like you guys do at home. And she's out. She's got to work a bit harder. She can't just stop down to the grocery store to pick up some food. She's got to go catch it. Oh, it looks like she's taking a break. Now, leopards like to lie on these big termite mounds, and it's a good spot where she can see. It gives her a bit of height to see all around her, to see if there's any potential meals about, or if there's any potential danger about, like lions. Hello, Megan. Megan, this isn't a cheetah, this is a leopard. And you can see its cheetah has single spots, whereas a leopard has rosettes. You can see multiple spots making up sort of circles. And this is a leopard, not a cheetah. And their fur on their bellies is quite soft. The rest of their fur is quite soft, I mean quite coarse. So it's got to be tough to protect them from all the thorns and trees and bushes that are out here. So she's listening as well. She's trying to hear if there's any animals around. And it's very hot today. It's been close to 100 degrees Fahrenheit. So being a big cat, she doesn't like the heat too much. They can't sweat like we can. So quite often they'll move for a little bit, then they'll lie down. It is getting cooler quite quickly. So we're with her at the right time of the day to catch her on the move. Hi, Rocky. Rocky would like to know if I know how many animals are out here. Well, Rocky, I've got an idea. I don't have exact numbers. We see probably 10 different leopards regularly. We see 15, 16, 17, 18. Oh, between about 16 or 17 different lions regularly. Elephants, we probably see a couple of hundred different elephants regularly. We don't know exactly how many animals are out there. We can just make educated guesses. This female leopard we see a lot. She's the main female leopard in this area, so her territory is here. So we do see her quite often. So we're going to wait here with this leopard to see what it does next. But I'm not the only one out here showing you the African bush. And this female leopard is not the only creature here. So let's go see what Byron's got.
And good afternoon to the school with us at this moment. We're still sitting with the lions. And a different group of lions that we had this afternoon. So Windsor Woods, I know you've just joined us, and this is a pair of lions, a big male and a beautiful female that we managed to find not too long ago. We were looking for them and fortunately got to find them. They've come out into the open. They were lying in the shade, but luckily for us, the cloud cover has built up and they don't have to worry about the sun too much, and I don't think they're going to have to worry about it anymore. It's disappearing behind some clouds now and probably going to stay there. So, Lance, you've asked the question, now, I think I'm hearing it correctly, that you want to know if what happens if the female lion loses her pack. I think that's what the question is. Now, lions are in groups that are called prides of lions. The term pack is actually used for wild dogs and not felines like all the big cats. Now, this lioness hasn't lost her pride. Occasionally what happens is if a male and female are potentially looking to mate, then they will move off away from a pride of lions. And we did see the rest of the family group or the pride earlier on during our safari. We managed to find the rest of them. There's four other females, adult females, and six little cubs. But they were lying in a very thick area in some shade and resting. And we actually quite far from where they are, but they will meet up again, Lance. They won't stay away from one another. They will indeed meet up again at some point, probably tonight, we never know, or tomorrow morning. The lions have the ability to cover huge distances, and they will meet up at some point again. They won't stay away or stay apart for very, very long. It's important that they stay together. They rely a lot on the prides. Now, Ryan, you asked how fast a lion can run. So a lion can generally, now we work in meters, but I'll try to work it out for you. A lion can run at about 20 to 22 meters per second if they're charging very, very quickly. So to give you an idea, this distance that we are at, if she got up and ran at us, she would be here within a second, literally a blink of an eye, very, very fast. So they are very fast. If you think of a sprinter, and with the Olympic Games, we have Usain Bolt, and he's the fastest man on earth at the moment, holding lots of world records, and he runs 100 meters in about 9.5 seconds. Now, a lion and a lioness, for that matter, would probably run 100 meters, so the same distance, in about 4.5 seconds. 4.5 to 5 seconds. So incredibly fast, almost double the speed of the fastest sprinter. You can see she's breathing heavily. Her belly actually looks quite full, so I wonder if they hadn't fed on something recently, maybe last night. I'm not sure. We didn't see them with anything or any food today. We've only seen them lying out in the open, but perhaps they ate something last night or the lioness did. So she's still got quite a full belly, but she's breathing heavily. Both of them are breathing heavily, and the reason for that is because they are hot. So the panting helps cool them down. The fly is bothering the lioness. Isn't she beautiful? Look at that beautiful lioness. But the flies, these little flies buzzing around at the moment, are called biting flies, and they do bite, and they do. It does sting a little bit. Actually, the bite feels quite sore. A little pinch. That's the best way to describe it. I would say it's like a little pinch. All right, now we are sitting with these lions and we're going to stay here for a while and see what they get up to. But while we are here, my friend Brent has got a beautiful leopard he'd like to show you.
Welcome back. We're still sitting with the female leopard. She's taking a little cat nap on top of the termite mound. Now, Sincere wants to know, why do leopards and cheetah look so similar? Well, there's a couple of reasons. It's a good camouflage. So spots or rosettes help break up the outline of the animal. But if you look closely, their body shape is quite different. Leopards are stockier, more compact. They actually weigh quite a lot more than a cheetah, even though a cheetah is taller. Cheetahs are skinny and long. Leopards are sort of quite thickly built. And leopards are ambush predators, which means they have to get very close before they can jump on and catch something, whereas a cheetah, with its incredible speed, can run for 100 meters or 200 meters at about 100 kilometers an hour, so very, very fast. Now, Sincere was also wondering, why is it called a leopard? And of course, most animal names come from way back when. And the source of a leopard's name, it comes from the olden days. And from ancient Greek, actually. And it is also from Sanskrit. It's a couple of different language, also Egyptian. And it basically meant a lion. It was a panther crossed with a lion. And now a panther is actually a leopard as well. So a black panther is just a leopard with a rare color morph. But that's where a leopard's name comes from. It's from ancient Greek and ancient Egyptian. Well, Samantha is wondering, what are all the bugs flying around the leopard's face? So, Samantha, you've just seen those same bugs with Byron, and they are the biting flies called stable flies that are trying to bite the leopard's ears and nose and any area that is a slightly less exposed, so where there's not a lot of fur. Those biting flies like to feed off the blood of all sorts of animals, not only leopards and lions, but wildebeest and zebra and impala, but also domestic animals, horses, dogs, sheep, goats. Now she's still very alert while she's sitting up there, watching carefully, listening carefully. Well, Hi, Bryn. Bryn's wondering, how do leopards get their food? Are they on a farm? Well, Bryn, they are out in the wild, so they've got to catch it for themselves. No one here to feed them. And this is an 8.5 million acre unfenced area that is for the wild animals to live in. And so she's got to try find some food, and then she's got to sneak up to it, and then she's got to jump on top of it and then kill it with her big teeth. Now, as it gets darker and the sun sets, it is time for the leopard to go hunting. So she has been hunting. She's an opportunist. She'll hunt day or night, but it's generally better when it's dark because she's got very good eyesight, about 8 times better than ours in the dark, and so better than the animals she's trying to catch. Hello, Ryan. Ryan would like to know, how do the animals survive in this hot weather? Well, Ryan, they don't move too much and they sleep in the shade. But so if they do have to move, they'll move for a short while, then they'll lie down and sleep again. And then once it cools down or their body cools down, they get up and move again. And see, she's breathing very heavily. That's her way of cooling. So she's got lots of blood vessels or veins in her mouth. And what happens is, as she breathes, the air she breathes in cools down the blood in her mouth, and then she pumps that through to the rest of her body. Copy, Andrew. Sorry, I was just on the radio there quickly, talking to Andrew. He's been sitting here with this leopard, but he's gone now. So I'm going to move forward a little bit. She is the Queen of Juma. Hi, Megan. Megan's wondering, are the big cats friends? Do they play with each other or do they hunt each other? Now, Megan, a lion is much bigger than a leopard and they don't like each other. So if a lion was to come across the leopard, it would try kill it. Now, a leopard, if they came across lion babies without a big lion there, the leopard would also try kill the lion's babies. So they are not friends, they are enemies. They are enemies because they compete for similar food sources. Oh, has she heard something? Now, Ryan's wondering, why do they these leopards have black lips or black lines? Well, the black bottom lip is actually, that's the color of her skin, Ryan. And that's why it's black. So, and you see the white under her eyes, or the light color around her eyes, is helps her see better in the dark. There we go. She's very alert now. She's getting ready to go hunting now. Although she has been hunting, this is the best time of the day as it goes into dark and leopards get moving because it's a bit cooler. They're able to move without getting too hot. Alan would like to know, what is a leopard's prey? Well, Alan, leopards eat small to medium-sized antelope. So from things as small as a rabbit or a hare up to things about as big as, a bit bigger than a white-tailed deer. So in this area, a leopard's favorite food is normally the impala, which is a type of antelope. And it's the most numerous antelope we have here. So that's the one they eat the most. Now I'm trying to remember if I've got a picture of an impala for you. Yeah, lots of pictures of lions and leopards, but where's the picture of the impala? Well, I can't find a picture of impala, but I have a picture of an inyala, which is another thing a leopard eats. There we go. Oopsie. Oh, I've pushed the wrong button. There it is. So that's an inyala antelope. That's a big male. That would probably only be taken down by a male leopard, not a female leopard. It's a bit big, but that's one of the antelope that a leopard eats. So a bit bigger than a white-tailed deer. Normally things about the same size as a white-tailed deer and smaller is what a leopard prefers to eat. Now we are hoping she is going to get moving shortly. Looking around, listening, trying to figure out where the other animals are, where her dinner is. Hi, Mackenzie. Mackenzie's wondering, do leopards find water easily? They do, Mackenzie, and they will drink when they have the choice to. But leopards are one of those animals that don't need to drink water. They get enough moisture from the blood of the animals they kill. But if there is water around, they will drink. You can see those big canine teeth that are used for gripping onto potential prey species. But hopefully she's going to get moving. We're going to sit here, keep an eye on her. While we do that, let's go back to Byron, who's with those gorgeous lions.
Now, we're still sitting with these lions that haven't moved much. It's still very, very hot, and I think that's why they're not interested in moving too much. But now, I know Brent was chatting to you about what leopards like to feed on. Now let me just show you quickly. This is what the impala feed on. I mean, what the leopards feed on, impala. Brent had mentioned them to you, and that is the impala antelope, and we've been seeing a lot of them around. There obviously won't be too many around here at the moment because of the lions, but that's what a leopard does prefer feeding on. It's a perfect size for a leopard, but they do feed on a range of animals, not just the impala. Lions will also feed on impala. There's a lot of impala in this area, and it's a good food source for a lot of the predators. Now, you wanted to know why the lions don't move in the heat, and the reason is Chinsia, I think. Sorry, I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. And you wanted to know why the lions don't. You wanted to know why the lions don't move in the heat, and the reason for that is because they conserve the energy when it's cooler. Just like we don't like moving when it's too hot. And they prefer moving when it's much cooler. So they conserve the energy now and they rest in the heat. And then during the course of the evening, when the temperature does drop down and it does become cooler, they'll probably move around a lot more. Well, that male seems to be, let's see, he's lifting his head a little bit. Megan, you wanted to know if that female lion or that mother lion is perhaps pregnant, and is the male protecting her? I don't think so. I'm not sure, Megan, but I don't think so. They've only just met up. So it was, I think, during the course of last night that they met up and they've stayed together. So no, I don't think that is the case at all. See the tail flicking? He's trying to get rid of some of the flies that are sitting on him. Well, Samantha, you've asked an interesting question about whether or not the big cats see in black and white. Now, Samantha, from what I've read, apparently they do. And now, people have done studies on the eyes of the lions and of predators, and what they found is that it depends. Now, this gets a little bit complicated, but inside our eyes, too, we've got something called rods and cones, and that determines our depth of perception and also the colors that we see. Same with these lions, and apparently they've done studies that shows the number of rods and cones in their eyes affects their eyesight slightly. Their eyesight is very, very good, but the color spectrum isn't as good as ours, and they do tend to see in shades of black and white. I don't know to what extent exactly, but it is a shade of black and white, but their eyesight is very, very good. And their eyesight is much better than ours when it comes to spotting movement or looking for animals in the distance. I was hoping this male would turn around and face us. There we go, there's a beautiful face. Oh, look at that. Isn't he magnificent? Those beautiful brown eyes, like a sandy brown. We call that a tawny color almost. That's the color of the lion. It's known as a tawny or sandy brown, golden brown. Now, Ryan, you wanted to know what the flies look like in Africa. Now, Ryan, I can't answer that, and I'll tell you why, because we've got so many different species of flies. There are many, many different types of flies in Africa, and they all look slightly different. They look pretty similar to some of the flies that you have in America. But some of them are also very, very colorful, and they've got different colors. So it's difficult to say exactly which ones because there are so many different types out here. I'm just watching this male. At least he's got his head up a little bit. Oh, look, the female's rolling over. Probably just getting hot and a bit uncomfortable. Now we've got some green wood hoopoes, beautiful birds that are calling in the distance, and we might be able to see them. They're on a dead tree straight ahead of us. They are just on the right hand side of the branch, and it's called a green wood hoopoe. And look at that, a very beautiful bird. The colors are a bit difficult to see at the moment because we don't have very good sunlight. But they've got a bright red beak, and you might be able to see it a little bit. There it goes. Gone. And let me show you a photo quickly. I'll find one on my app. I'll be able to show you exactly what that bird looks like. There we go. And I'm hoping there's one. There we go. Look at that. So it was very difficult to actually see the colors, but that's the color if the sun hits it, and you get the beautiful, what we call iridescence. Now, it's a big word, iridescence. It's the shine on the feathers, that beautiful sheen that we get, and you can see that bright red beak. Let me see if there's another picture for you. There we go. That's kind of what we saw. We saw the black and white under the tail and that bright red beak, and there it's catching an insect. So they feed on insects, and they've got a slightly greenish tinge to them, greenish coloration. That's why they're known as the green wood hoopoe. Beautiful birds, and that's what we could hear calling. Now, Alan, you wanted to know if all the male lions have manes, and yes, Alan, they generally do. There have been cases in the past where male lions haven't necessarily grown these big manes, and that could be for a number of reasons, probably genetic, not too sure, or perhaps testosterone, so just the genetic makeup of the lions. But generally speaking, all male lions have these big beautiful manes, and the reason why they have them and the females don't is because the males do tend to fight a lot more and also fight for territory. And when they're fighting other males, that big mane, watch, oh, big yawn and down. Now, that big mane, that very thick hair around the head and the neck, helps protect them. So if they are fighting and they get bitten around the head or the neck, it helps protect them so they don't cause any serious injury to one another. You can actually see the scars on that male lion on the nose from fighting with other lions, probably males or even the females. Kyra, you want to know, how do the animals find shelter? So Kyra, they don't necessarily. What happens, I mean, some animals do look for homes, and they will move into thickets or under logs, some of the smaller insects and small animals like squirrels and mongoose. But lions, for example, they might just lie under the shade of a tree to get out of the heat, or if it's raining, maybe move into some thicker bush to try and cover a little bit. But they don't necessarily go and specifically look for shelter. There's nowhere that they could go out here. But they are adapted to deal with those types of surroundings and the weather change, so the animals are much better suited to be out here than we are. Now, I'm going to sit for a little while longer with these lions, and while I do that, let's head over to Brent, and I think the leopard is moving.
So there we go, she's on the move, she's hunting through the woodland, she's walking, stopping, listening, trying to find her dinner and dinner for her two babies that she's left hidden in a bush somewhere. I'm going to keep following her. Hi, Mackenzie. Mackenzie's wondering, why don't big cats' eyes look like ours? Well, Mackenzie, because they're designed for a completely different thing. So, of course, they're all designed to see, but a big cat's eyes don't see detail like we do. It sees in various shades of gray and black and white, and her eyes are designed specifically to pick up little bits of movement through the bush, whereas ours, we need to see color, we need to see detail, so we don't eat the wrong fruit, or we don't eat unripe fruit. So she doesn't need to see in color, and her eyes are designed to pick up movement of animals, so that's better in black and white when there's less colors to distract her. So there we go. She's probably going to scent mark now. What that means. There we go. She's going to do it now. See, she sprays a little bit of urine. Oh, tired kitty yawning. And then what that does is tells all the other leopards that this is her. Oh, wasn't that amazing? That is a leopard's roar. She's doing that with the scent mark. That's to tell all other leopards that this is her territory and they mustn't come here. So it's the equivalent if we had to put up a fence around our property. She marks it with urine and then she calls saying, "It's mine, it's mine, it's mine, it's mine." Now, quite often, you will find leopards walking down a road like this, although we've been following her through the bush. Now, a lot of these roads are built where there used to be big game paths, so now it's just like a double-lane highway for animals. Here we go. That's really special. You don't get to see them call too often. Now, Lance is wondering, how would the leopards respond if there was a wildfire? Well, Lance, the leopards would get out of the way. They're very, very quick, and they normally get far away from a wildfire or find a spot where they're safe from it. So they're not really in danger from wildfires. Most of the animals in the bush here are very good at getting away from wildfires. And the only really the smaller things like tortoises and chameleons get caught up in the fires. So here we go, isn't this exciting? We're following a leopard on her evening hunt, her evening stroll, although she's calling, so it could be, you could say, her evening territorial marking and a territorial march, make sure no other leopards are coming into her area. Now, as that leopard walks, you can see its shoulder blade sticking out quite prominently. And Samantha's wondering why, and can you tell me about the shoulder blades? Well, they're very, very supple, Samantha. So her shoulder blades need to have that amount of movement because she can run very fast. She can do about 22 meters per second. She also needs to be very supple to climb trees. So that's why her shoulder blades come out when she walks like that. Hi, Mackenzie. Mackenzie's wondering, do the tails of cats help with anything? Well, you can see there's a white tip to that leopard's tail. That's to help the babies follow her when she's moving through the bush. And also, their tails help with balance. So it helps them when they're going very fast or climbing trees, just to even out their balance. Now, in cheetah, it's very important. It helps, it almost acts as a rudder when they're running very fast to help them not fall over. Well, she's stopping for her evening constitutional, and she might call again now. There's another big marula next to her, that one there. Now, that means she might scent mark that. So they generally like to scent mark prominent trees along roots. So there we go, putting up her fence. Well, not going to call this time. She is heading to an area where there's often a lot of impala, so she might be listening to see if there's a possible meal around the corner. Hi, Kyra. Kyra's wondering, have big cats over time become carnivores? I think they evolved as carnivores from very, very early on, Kyra. So they've been carnivores for as long as they've been big cats. Now, all different animals have different niches, and they're obviously a carnivore. We're an omnivore, so we eat both. And then, of course, antelope and deer, those are herbivores, so they only eat grass or leaves. Hi, Samantha. Samantha is wondering, why are the leopard's paws black? Well, it's the same reason their lip is black. It's the color of their skin. And same reason why your dog's paws are black. It's also probably been hardened and got some dirt on it, which makes it even darker. Now, Lance is wondering, if a leopard lost her babies, how would she find them? Well, Lance, she would call, like we saw there, but if she thinks they're close by, she would call much softer, with a sort of call that sounds like this, ow, ow, or chuff, which is when she puffs up her cheeks and goes.
But if she can't find them for a while, she will call like we just saw her calling that. Now, Sincere is wondering, does this leopard know that we're following her in our car? I'm pretty sure she does, Sincere, but she is used to the cars, and if we drive carefully and we don't disturb her, she just completely ignores us. So she carries on doing what she would do even if we weren't here. Now see how she stops and listens every little while, and that's to check if there's any potential food up ahead. There we go, she's going to put up her fence again. Now it rained last night, which means her fence probably got washed away, or the smell of her fence. That's why she's walking and scent marking again. Now the most wonderful thing about a leopard scent mark is that it smells exactly like buttered popcorn. It's a very pleasant smell. While we keep following her to see what she does next, let's go back to Byron, who says the lions are looking a little bit more awake.
And look at this. He's still lying here, not interested in moving. Let's try to put a bit of light on them. There we go. A few yawns, but no real movement just yet. It's still very, very hot, humid and muggy. So I don't think they'd be interested in moving anytime soon. Who knows? Maybe we're lucky and later this evening we might hear them. Ryan, you've asked, in ancient times was there a lot of hunting in Africa? There was indeed. But Ryan, it was different hunting. You know, people that lived in Africa many, many years ago, even 100 years ago, they would have lived in these areas, and to survive they would have had to hunt for food. They wouldn't have hunted unnecessarily. It would only have been to feed the families. And the best example of people like that would be the Bushmen. Now the Bushmen were found in areas up kind of this, the northern part of South Africa into Botswana and the northwest towards the Kalahari Desert. Now those bushmen would specifically hunt and find food out in the bush. They would live off the land, but they were very clever. They were always very respectful of wildlife and of nature, and they would only hunt for what they needed. They would never hunt more, because they felt that if they hunted more, they would kill out the animals that they survived off of. So they're very respectful, and they'd only hunt what they needed. But there was definitely a lot of hunting in this area. Now I'm going to leave these lions for a second, because we managed to find the other lions. Remember I said to you there are some other males around that were around earlier, and they're not too far from here, but they've been hiding from us. They've moved a little bit, so I'm hoping we're going to see them. Let's see if we can find them quickly. They're not far from here. And these two, we're going to leave them and let them rest some more. Here we go, and these ones, looks like this male, the one male has got his head up. Let's see, where's the other one? I only see the one now. All right, so let's just have a look here. Look at that beautiful male. So here's one of the other males. Now this is a brother of that big male that we can see with that female. And that is why he's allowed to be here. If he wasn't a brother, he would definitely be chased off by that big male. All right, so goodbye to Windsor Woods Elementary. I hope you've had a wonderful afternoon with us and that you've learned something. It was great to have you, and we'll hopefully see you soon again on Safari Live. Goodbye, everyone.
Well, welcome back to everyone. It is really important that we help to educate the future conservationists of the world. So thanks for bearing with us through that. And it is fun for us as well to entertain the kids. But we're still with Karula. She is heading now towards the western, or towards Vuyatela Access junction with Zoe's Road. She's just moved off the road slightly. This is the longest she's walked on a road since I've been following in a while. VM and I were commenting, it was quite pleasant not to have to try and maneuver through the bush after her. Oh, sorry, I forgot my hat. It's very hot, there's not a breath of wind. I just need to give an update to the game drive. On the game drive radio, Kula's mobile north along Zoe's towards Vertila Access. Oh, it looks like our... Come on, Kula, come back to the road. Oh dear. I think she's going to head into these thickets now. And as I said, she's quite hungry. She's got two babies to feed. There's a good chance there's some impala in this area. See, her tail's up. She's been spotted by a fork-tailed drongo that was shouting. Come back towards the road, Karula. Hi, Jay. Jay's wondering how many subspecies of leopard there are in the world. Well, Jay, that's quite a difficult question. I'm going to have to double check on that for you, but I'm going to have to keep up with her as well. If she goes into an area that's too thick, we're going to leave her be. Can still make her out. It's not that far from here towards the power lines. That's why I'm going to stick with her. But if I feel us crashing around might affect her hunt, then I'm just gonna let her disappear into the darkness. But at the moment, she's just scent marking prominent spots. Okay, so there we go, Jay. I found that what I was looking for while she stopped to scent mark. The ICUN recognized different 9 species in the world. The African leopard, sub-Saharan Africa, the Indian leopard, the Javan leopard, the Arabian leopard, the Amur leopard, the North Chinese leopard, and Persian leopard, the Indo-Chinese leopard, and the Sri Lankan leopard. And last but not least, the Anatolian leopard in Turkey. And then a possible, not confirmed, another one, the Balochistan leopard, Pakistan, bordering with Afghanistan. But that one, they don't have enough genetics to confirm that. Ooh. Can you still see her, VM? Okay.
11 o'clock. Well, there's one termite mound. We'll go to the termite mound. It looks like it's getting a bit thick on the other side. But if we can't see her from that termite mound, I think we'll let her hunt in peace. She does have those two hungry little monsters to feed. The other option is we could leave her and then try guess where she's going to pop out towards the power lines. That might be an option. Yeah, I know. And here's the termite mound. She's not here. It's getting a little thick. And of course, I don't want to interfere in her hunt. I want her to be as successful as possible to feed those two little tykes. So we're going to let her disappear. What I might do is shoot around to where the power lines are and try guess where she's going to come out and wait there. We might see her, we might not. But I'd rather her have the best chance at hunting without us crashing around after her. In the meantime, let's go back to Byron and those lions.
Now, these lions have moved slightly, maybe a meter. They just changed positions, but they seem to be getting a bit more active. And let's see, so we had that other male not far off, but he's just kind of laying in the drainage line not far from these two, and these two moved again, so I thought let's come back to them and see what they get up to. Now, potentially this male might be wanting to mate with this female, but we haven't seen any mating activity yet, so I'm not sure. Let's just listen here quickly. Listen. Now this male is growling. Because the two other males, they're both here. Just having a look, the one is moving behind us. And the other one I can see is actually just in the thicket, just through here, sorry Jandre, is lying down there somewhere. There you can get a glimpse of the tail moving. It's a bit difficult, but look, here comes this male behind us. Let's just see what he does. Malakita, you wanted to know if this lioness, I'm just trying to make sure I got the question right again, I didn't hear it properly the first time, but you wanted to know, I think, if the lioness comes into estrus again, if she's lost cubs or if she's had cubs before. I can't remember exactly, or I didn't hear the whole question properly. Maybe Rebecca can just let me know again what it was. Okay, so Malakita, you wanted to know, will the lioness come into estrus or into season before those cubs leave the pride? Now remember, we've spoken about this a few times before. The cubs don't actually leave the pride. Those young cubs will just grow up and stay within the pride and cause the pride to grow. Now, mainly the females. The young males at some point will eventually move off, but not the females. They will stay with the pride. Now, usually what happens is these lionesses will wait until those cubs are about a year and a half to 2 years old before they come into estrus again, if she is definitely one of the mothers. I don't think this female is one of the mothers, so she would most likely come into estrus fairly soon if she isn't in estrus already. And I think she may be, because this male seems so interested in this female, and she often gets separated from the pride and these males are trying to mate with her. But as I said, we haven't seen any mating activity yet, but she would definitely be when she does come into estrus, they will try and mate with her. Oh, bless you, little sneeze there. So usually it's until those cubs are about a year and a half to 2 years old before those females come into estrus again and are ready to mate. If they lose the cubs, however, if something happens and the cubs die, they will come into estrus a lot quicker. We've seen that with the Styx Pride. They unfortunately lost some cubs and came into estrus a lot quicker and they mated again. So it can happen if they lose their cubs, they will then come into estrus a lot sooner than usual. These lions, to be honest, I don't think are going to move anytime soon. It's still very, very hot, and they could be lying here for another 10 minutes, or it could be an hour and a half. We don't know. But it was lovely to see them and spend some time with them. I'm trying to think if we shouldn't perhaps leave these lions, let them carry on resting, and see, while we've still got some time, see what else we can perhaps find with the spotlight. Maybe we get lucky and find something nocturnal. So I think let's do that. We've got a few minutes. Let's just see what else we can find. Maybe we get lucky and... And what a lovely sighting. I'm glad we got to see these lions, and we seem to be surrounded by lions, and I'll show you why. Hang on. There's a big male lion lying behind me, so this could get interesting. Maybe I'm not going anywhere just yet. Sorry. I'm trying hard to move without disturbing him too much. We've got a few trees and that behind us. Look at him. So we are kind of blocked at the moment. So my plan has just changed. We are going to stay and watch these lions. And it just shows you never know what's going to happen in the bush. All right, it sounds like Brent has managed to get out of that thick bush where he followed Karula into. Let's head back to him and see what he's up to.
Well, we did, and we left Karula. She's heading further to the west, so I think a good place to start looking for her tomorrow morning will be around Impala Plains, Balanites tree. So she changed her direction. I thought she might come out here, but doesn't look like it. It looks like she went further to the southwest. So, well, what a wonderful afternoon, though. I mean, lions and Karula. It has been great. It's our back, which is always good news. Now, of course, hopefully we find a little nocturnal critter. White-tailed mongoose, a genet, a civet, a chameleon, a bush baby, all options. It is still ridiculously warm. There's not a breath of wind at the moment, and it is very, very moggy and humid. Well, Karula should have come this way. There's Nyala and Impala, baby Impala. I'm just gonna turn the lights off so I don't blind them. And always wonderful to have good old Jempse and Jemps, Commander Bond, the Dashund, many other nicknames. Good rate to have him back. Looks well rested after his time abroad. There, we passed that Inyala and Impala. We have seen civet in this area quite a few times. More baby Impala. Sorry, lights down. Hi, Genevieve. Genevieve says this is her 2-year anniversary at Safari Live. She says thanks very much to the whole team. It really means a lot to her. And she asked in
as well. What does my time mean at Safari Live? Well, it's been absolutely fantastic being able to showcase Africa and Africa's nature to a whole host of people that sometimes might never be able to get out here. And it has been incredible. We get to learn with you. And that's the one thing I do enjoy. You never know enough out here in the African bush. Every day is another learning day. Like I learned today about that there are 9 recognized subspecies of leopard. And of course, sometimes we tend to get quite insular because we're driving around these areas looking at the African leopard. But there's, of course, Indian leopards, Amur leopards, Indo-Chinese leopards, Anatolian leopards. It's absolutely incredible. Now, this little run's normally good for bush babies. Where are they hiding today? As I said, I think we're probably going to have to try start figuring out where their new roots are, because they're not so focused on eating acacia gum at the moment. And I think they're going to be gorging on insects mostly, and possibly some fruit. So I think if I don't get any bush babies in this area tonight, I think we're going to have to start looking in different areas, because of course as the seasons change, the animals will change their roots and behaviors slightly, especially something like a bush baby that during the hard dry months has to survive off gum and the odd insect it can catch. But now with the rain, all the insects around, the bush babies will be eating mostly insects in it and some fruit. Well, alas, no bush babies here, but it has been wonderful having you on this sweltering sunset safari, and we look forward to doing it all again in a few short hours tomorrow morning. So from Viam and myself, goodbye, and we'll see you tomorrow.
So we still haven't been able to move, but that's all right. We'll sit here a little bit longer. Maybe these lions decide to move. And there's a yawn, a beautiful, beautiful yawn. That's a good sign that they potentially may decide to move. And let's see what happens. But as Brent said, it's been a scorcher of a sunset safari. Very, very hot this afternoon, and it's still very hot, very humid and muggy. And I see some cloud covers and lightning in the distance. Who knows, maybe we get another bit of a storm later tonight. That would be wonderful, cool things down again. Sorry, a lot of bugs around here. I'm getting bitten. Donna Lee, you say this is a Ryan Lodebrok. See, it's time I think I head back to the camp. It's a lion roadblock, you're right, it is. And it's the best roadblock ever, definitely. Oh dear, see what the heat does. I think it fries our brains a little bit out here, perhaps. Who knows? But we've had such a wonderful afternoon. I hope you have all enjoyed it with us too. We got to see the Nkuhuma pride, got to see the two and a half males. There was another male hiding in the bush, and then the other lioness here. And then Brent obviously had luck with Karula. So it's been a fantastic afternoon safari, or sunset safari. Really, really very fortunate. Just shows you, occasionally things can just happen. From times where there's not much going on to cats everywhere. It's been very, very fortunate. And it's nice to have James back, and he'll be back on safari tomorrow morning again. And day 2 on our cat streak. But, as I said, great to have James back. Hope you enjoyed the walk with him earlier. And from Brent, I know I said goodbye earlier too. And Viam. And it's nice to have Brian back too, and the thumb. But from myself and from Jandre, who was on camera with me today, thank you for a wonderful afternoon. I hope you've all enjoyed it. Goodbye, good night. Sorry.